Now, new developments in the field of biomedical research. Special correspondent Dave Iverson was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease in 2004 and has been reporting on the search for effective treatments for that disease and others. He filed this report for our health unit, a partnership with the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation.
Scott Johnson has had multiple sclerosis for 34 years. He's coped with everyday challenges, like how to drive a car.
It's impacted, you know, virtually all my adult life. You know, my right hand doesn't really work very well, or really at all. My right leg doesn't work great.
I actually need someone to show me what I weigh now. That's good.
David Anderson's challenges are different. He has kidney disease, and a transplanted kidney failed 3 years ago. Today, he depends on dialysis to survive.
When I need dialysis, mostly I notice that I feel sort of muddy in my thinking. You know, the toxins in the blood are not just in your leg muscles, they're all over your body, including in your brain.
David Anderson and Scott Johnson contend with very different conditions, but they share a similar frustration, the slow pace of medical advancements.
So why isn't more progress being made towards solving a variety of complex diseases? After all, the National Institutes of Health spend over $30 billion a year in research. The problem may not be how much money we spend on research, but the medical research system itself, and a problem sometimes known as the Valley of Death.
A problem that frustrates patient advocates like Scott Johnson.
The Valley of Death really is a gap in the overall process. So you've got, at the front end of the process, you've got academics that are doing basic science research. And the result of that is about 800,000 papers published every year. That's a lot of papers. At the other end of the spectrum, you've got the pharmaceutical and biotech industry that actually has to turn things into medicines.
To bridge the gap, Johnson says, requires scientific grunt work that often doesn't get done.
You need to replicate experiments many times, and that just doesn't get funding. That's not something that's interesting for an academic to do. It's not something that helps their career. It's not something they can get a grant to do. And so those steps just don't happen. And on the other end of the spectrum, you say, well, why doesn't pharma do it? Well, it's because how do you wade through 800,000 papers and figure out what is the gem that I should put all this money in to do these steps?
So 9 years ago, Johnson decided to leave his career as a Silicon Valley executive and start a foundation aimed at speeding the research process and finding a new treatment for MS. To do so, he immersed himself in the world of science.
One of the exciting things is that we found that it looks like it's turning on some genes, but also turning off other genes.
Johnson got to know Dr. Ben Barris, who, as chair of the neurobiology department at Stanford University, was knee-deep in the world of academic research.
We worked very hard for a few years, and we published a paper in a good journal, and I always assumed that that discovery, if it were immediately relevant to a new treatment, would be picked up by one of the big drug companies and then develop the next step. And so I thought I was doing my part.
Like most researchers, Barris had focused on intriguing scientific questions, but not on the ones that might help patients most. In multiple sclerosis, the body's immune system attacks something called myelin, which sheathes the nerves. Without it, the brain can't tell muscles what to do. To date, most research had focused on why myelin goes missing, but not on the practical question of how to repair it. Then Scott Johnson came along.
And so he sort of embarrassed everybody, you know, from coast to coast into saying we've got to be working more on this question.
Johnson's Myelin Repair Foundation has now raised $43 million for research, including much of the work that Ben Barris is now engaged in. But the funding deliberately comes with strings attached. The research must be patient-centered. Scientists must work collaboratively and provide the kind of data that would persuade drug companies to take the next step. A model that could work for other diseases, too.
I'm Sue Desmond-Hellman, the new chancellor.
The new chancellor at the University of California, San Francisco, knows something about getting private industry to move forward. Dr. Susan Desmond-Hellman came to her new position at UCSF fresh from Genentech, where she oversaw the development of breakthrough cancer drugs like Herceptin in the 1990s. But Desmond-Hellman thinks private industry has become less willing to make those investments.
There is concern today that that kind of innovation, that kind of basic science and following it with great translation and clinical science is too rare.
To reignite innovation, Desmond-Hellman believes academic scientists have to take on the collaborative approach she once witnessed at Genentech.
The experience that I had in private industry, I always worked as a member of a team, and that was great fun. I couldn't be and wouldn't be the expert at all things, but if in the end something good happened, I was happy and rewarded for that, for a good outcome, not whether I published.
And is that something that you're trying to inculcate here at UCSF, that more collaborative, interdisciplinary approach?
Absolutely.
And that collaborative principle is gaining adherence. At the San Francisco Veterans Administration, an Alzheimer's brain imaging project uses a novel data-sharing approach. The project draws on funding from government, industry, and academia. It's led by Dr. Michael Weiner of UCSF and the Veterans Administration.
When any scientific project is done, the scientist collects the data, keeps it in their laboratory, and then writes a paper about the data. That is, the raw data is not released, just a paper which is a description of the raw data.
But this time, scientists did the opposite.
We decided for a number of reasons to just share all the data that we collect from this study and to share it widely on the internet, and the results of that have just been amazing.
The Alzheimer's study followed 800 patients at 50 different centers. The researchers all had instant access to the same data and worked collaboratively to figure out a way to detect Alzheimer's early on, a potentially significant breakthrough.
What's extremely interesting is that we're seeing signs in the completely normal people
early on
that they have biomarker signatures of Alzheimer's disease.
So, I mean, in a way, is this like having real-time, open-source research? Is that what's different?
Yes.
And it's research that's both collaborative and patient-focused, which Chancellor Desmond-Hellman says has to be the primary academic goal.
Increasingly, what people call translational science, or I would call clinical science, or human biology, is allowing us to say, that science question you just asked and answered, first of all, is that relevant to a human being? And secondly, what about the patient?
Which takes us back to David Anderson, the kidney disease patient we met at the beginning of this story. Right now, he faces the prospect of being hooked up to a machine 3 days a week for the rest of his life. But a new development has changed those prospects.
The information I got recently about this, the possibility of creating an implantable artificial kidney, well, you know, that's something worth hanging around for.
So what we have here is a little model of our device.
This is not an artificial kidney is in the works at the laboratory of Dr. Shuvo Roy.
And this would actually be implanted and would be roughly this size, but lighter?
This may look big to us, but actually, to give you some context, it certainly would fit within the abdomen of most of us.
Dr. Roy is an engineer by training. But the project brought together cell biologists, material scientists, engineers, and practicing physicians.
By finding those right people together, I think we can sort of take out the traditional way of doing academic research in silos, but saying, let's put our arms together and brains together and solve a problem collectively. And for a project like this, you absolutely need that to succeed.
It's the same collaborative approach that Scott Johnson's Myelin Repair Foundation is promoting, changing the model for how research works, and solving the problem of multiple sclerosis that's challenged him for 34 years.
And to be able to prevent others from having to go through that, I think, is, to me, would be something I'd like to do. But probably on a larger scale, it's really about the model, because I think that this model can be applied to any disease research.
And of course, there's no shortage of diseases still to tackle.